सर्वव्यापकमद्वितीयमजरं वेदान्तविज्ञापितं द्वन्द्वाभासविवर्जितं भवहरं शान्तिप्रदं देहि नाम कर्माकर्मविकर्महीनममलं त्रैगुण्यविच्छेदकं ध्यायेत् ब्रह्म सदा प्रशान्तमनसा भक्त्या च सश्रद्धया ध्यायेत् ब्रह्म सदा प्रशान्तमनसा भक्त्या च सश्रद्धया हरि. सो व्हाट डिड वी डिस्कस यस्टरडे? We said that the sadhana chatushtaya, which is very important in Upanishadic knowledge pursuit, so much so that it is considered to be the how much of these pursuits you are given to, that will determine whether you have the adhikara, whether you are fit for knowledge or not. At the same time, I mentioned that, and there in the sadhana chatushtaya, the viveka is the foundation. It is the most important of the four. Because without the foundation, you cannot build the palace over that. It starts from the foundation, and the effect of the foundation is till the end also. So much is important. It is important. At the same time, in Bhagavad Gita, the word viveka is not there. That I wanted to particularly point out. See, we are reading the shastras, we are studying Bhagavad Gita, we are studying Kathopanishad, we are studying Viveka Chodamani. But the knowledge is the same. It's the self-knowledge, it is about the same thing. Now, these questions should strike our mind, that what is this that so much has been discussed about it in Viveka Chudamani, in Panchadashi, which is the basic book for this, in the Upanishads also. Kathopanishad, the whole first two chapters are only to show that Nachiketa had this sadhana chatushtaya in ample measure. From his behavior, it is analysis is from his behavior. It starts with Shraddha dawned in Nachiketa's mind, that one of the six treasures. Right in the beginning, he says, seeing the behavior of the father who was given to rituals, seeing the behavior of the father, Shraddha dawned in Nachiketa's mind. Why? Because he finds that the father doesn't have any value for whatever he is doing. For whatever he is doing absolutely wrong. Now it starts with that, and it goes like that, that finally Yamaraja says that, oh Nachiketa, you are a satyadhruti, satyadhrutirvatasi, that means, satyadhruti means who can retain the truth. All of us, even if you listen to the truth, by the time you go to the anakshatra, the truth has already leaked. So, the dhruti we don't have. The more we pursue this, our dhruti, satyadhruti should increase. So, Yamaraja was very happy seeing that Nachiketa has that retentivity. Dhruti means the retentivity of the truth. Whatever is told, he is able to absorb and narrate also again, recap everything. He also said, more and more people like you come, more and more Shishyas like you come to us. Yamaraja tells Nachiketa. He also, at the end, he says, Brahma Sadhana is wide open before you. You simply walk in. That means the sadhana chatushtaya, as it grows, you are coming to the goal. And goal is nothing but the further and further cultivation of these four qualities. Goal is nothing else. It is the zenith of viveka. It is the zenith of vairagya. and correspondingly all other things will come by itself. So Viveka and Vairagya are given the maximum importance. Whereas in Bhagavad Gita, Viveka word has not been used, if I am true. I don't know, nobody has said that yes, it has been used so far. So if it has not been used, then what is it? So I was telling that the whole Bhagavad Gita is on Viveka only. But they have not used the word Viveka. They have used the Buddhi Yukta. And when the Buddhi Yukta and Buddhi Yoga, it comes from 2.50 onward. In Bhagavad Gita, 2nd chapter, 50 verse, 49 also it is mentioned. He says, after after presenting Sankhya and then presenting, defining what is yoga, in the 2.48 he has defined yoga. Yogastha kuru karmani sangam tyaktva dhananjaya siddhya siddhyo samabhutva samattam yoga uchyate. This is the definition of yoga in Bhagavad Gita. That samatva is called yoga. Now what is samatva? Siddhya siddhyo samabhutva. How do you remain equal in success as well as failure, sukha as well as dukkha, in all dual situations of the world? How do you remain sama, uniform? He says, sangam, yogastha kuru karmani sangam tyaktva dhananjaya. That you act but always remaining fixed in yoga, established in yoga. And when will you say that you are established in yoga? When you can do everything without the sangha. Sangha means clinging. That clinging to what I like and negative clinging or hating what I dislike. So, what is this yoga? He says that buddhau sharanam anmiccha kripanaha phalahetavaha. He says that whatever you are doing, you take refuge in your buddhi. So that yoga is through intelligence. It is a pursuit through intelligence. And rest are all kripanaha phalahetavaha. Why? The people are acting because their mind is always that they are looking for happiness. This I have explained earlier also, that Bhagavad Gita, the first discovery of our scriptures, or particularly Bhagavad Gita, is that we are born with an abhava bodha. Abhava bodha means insufficiency. From birth itself we have an insufficiency in us. Unless we have insufficiency, we will not look for happiness outside. Is it not so? What happens to a knower? He becomes fulfilled. What is the meaning of fulfilled? That is, there is no insufficiency. So he no longer looks for any happiness from the world. Because he knows that the happiness is right there in himself. So he doesn't want anything from the world. That doesn't mean that he will not do anything. He will do everything out of happiness, out of joy. But not looking for joy at the end. Whereas, why do people get bound? Bhagavad Gita says that the karma, the action are binding us. Why? Because we are performing the actions under a delusion. That whatever the result of the karma, that will make me happy. It is not the objective result he is talking about. Suppose I am preparing for an exam. And I am writing the exam, I am passing the exam, I am going to another class or I am going for a job. These are all results. Everything is the result of the work. But our mind is not on the job we are doing. That getting the result, I will become happy. Getting the success, I will become happy. So our mind is on the happiness. That is the phala. So we become constricted in our mind. Right from the beginning in doing a work, we start getting anxious. We start getting fearful that if I don't get them, what will happen? If I don't pass the exam, then what will happen? If I don't get first class, what will happen? And that hinders our work also. We are not able to study because of the anxiety, worry. But the anxiety is worry not for the work. If you study well and write the exam well, automatically you will write it well and you will have your result. But our mind is always focused on happiness. So the kripanaha phalahetavaha is those who are looking always for looking for happiness from getting some result, getting from the world, they are miserly, they are constricted in their mind, because they don't have that vast mind with which they can work joyfully whatever to be done and whatever results come, they are happy on their own. So actually the kripanata or miserliness, we say, generally we use the kripana word for only financial miserliness, that one who hoards money and doesn't give money, we say kripana, miserly. But in Brihadaranyaka, Yajnavalkya says that one who leaves this world without knowing his real identity is the kripana. O Gargi, one who leaves the world without knowing the truth about his own universal identity, his vast identity, his universal identity, he is a kripana, because his mind remains constricted. So how that kripanata will go? Immediately Bhagavad Gita, buddhi yukto jahatiha ubhe sukrita duskrite tasmad yogaya yujyasva yogah karma sukaushalam. So buddhi yuktaha, the right from the beginning he is introducing that it is the intelligence which has to be connected. Connected to what? Connected to the soul dimensions, as I explained yesterday. That it should remain anchored in the soul. In meditation, what yesterday I explained? That in meditation, we are trying to know the soul, which is impersonal, impartial, universal, untainted, unaffected by everything. So these are the dimensions of the soul. Is it not? So in our active life, every moment also, this should be our goal. So in our active life, we are not sitting without any function. We are functional. But in while remaining active, our mind is always on that this will make me happy. That has to be replaced by the soul dimensions. That wherever we are to look into the mind and wherever we are going away from the soul dimensions, we have to incorporate that. We have to cultivate those dimensions. That means we have to work in that manner, not with the kripanata of I will become happy. So these two things we are born with. One is the insufficiency for which we look for happiness. Another is the delusion that we think something from the world will make me happy. Although we look back and see the whole history of humanity, that nobody has ever become happy by getting anything from the world. The richest person in the world, the most famous person in the world, the most powerful king in the world, nobody has become happy by their anything they have got from the world. But still we think that we will become happy by getting some, even a puny thing from the world, I will become happy. So our happiness never comes because of this delusion. Whereas happiness is our birthright. It is right there in our real identity, in our soul. We are born of that happiness. Anandadhyeva khalvivani bhutani jayante. Not only we, everybody is born of anand. So, to remove this delusion, we have to anchor our buddhi in the soul dimension, in our inmost reality. Now, when we anchor our buddhi in the inmost reality, that is, we put in the buddhi the soul dimensions as its goal, then that buddhi becomes viveka buddhi. That is no more a vishaya buddhi, which is looking for small, small happiness, small, small love, small, small appreciation from the world. It no longer looks for that. It becomes the viveka buddhi. That is, it is always identifying the permanent happiness, that which will not depend on the world. I will not look for any happiness from the world. The happiness is right there. It is a self-parameter. It is a self-coordinate. It is a self-characteristic. And I will be happy with that and do everything. So that happiness becomes permanent. It is not the usual happiness we think of, that, oh, we are laughing and clapping, that kind of a happiness. But it is, in Bhagavad Gita, it is called generally sukham atyantikam or prasada. That means, which is equally there in dukkha as well as sukha. And that is permanent. Dukkha sukha floats in that happiness. The happiness doesn't go. The prasada doesn't go. That is the placidity of the mind Bhagavad Gita speaks about. And the path towards that is the Viveka, is the Buddhi Yoga. That means how do you attain it? By establishing the Buddhi in the soul dimension. Then the Buddhi becomes the Viveka Buddhi. So this Viveka is the ultimate. Here also Viveka will take us to the ultimate. So this is the synthesis of Bhagavad Gita and the Viveka Chudamani. Not only here, entire Upanishad, even in Panchadashi is considered to be one of the basic scriptures. Because fundamentally, in a precise manner, briefly, everything is there. It is called Panchadashi because it has got 15 chapters. And each chapter is named in a... It's very interesting because it is not a very old scripture. It is written in 13th century, 1350, around that period, by Vidyaranya. I think many of you know about the story. Vidyaranya, I am diverting again, but it is interesting to know our country. Through these people, we will know what our country is. Vidyaranya's name was Madhavacharya. In his Purvashrama, name was Madhavacharya. And his brother also, most probably his brother, Sayanacharya, who was very famous Veda Tikakar also. So he had joined the Sringeri Acharya, Bharati Tirtha. He took sannyasa from Bharati Tirtha. But that was the time the Alauddin's people, they invaded Madurai and they destroyed, Sri Rangam temple and all those things. They ransacked everything. So generally south was protected. The Muslim invasion did not come so much here. But sometimes it had come and destroyed everything. So at the same time, Vijayanagara kingdom also was passing through a bad phase. They did not have a good king. So its power had fallen. That is how the Muslims could, the Islamic invasion could enter. And they pervaded the south, Dakshinatya, as we say. So seeing the condition of the country, and they understood that although we are studying the scripture, because now it is independent India, we will never understand how it is that we are comfortably coming for a retreat, getting all the vada and everything and reading the Bhagavad Gita. Or today more than vada was the Ada Pradhaman Payasam, some special payasam which needs 6 people to struggle for one day perhaps. All these things we are having. Whereas in the days of British rule, you could not even do puja in your temple properly. Rani Rasmani, you know how her house was attacked by the British people. How she had to fight for everything. She was a great powerful lady in Calcutta. So naturally the saints, they understood that we will not be able to retain our culture if the country is invaded by these people. So the Vidyaranya was very much affected by the whole situation. And in his mind it was brewing that I must save the country. Finally it became so strong that he talked to his guru and came back to, whether he left sannyasa I don't know. It is said in some books it is so, some books it is not. His sannyasa name was Vidyaranya. So he came back to the society and with 2 other very powerful people, the names I have forgotten, he established the proper kingdom in Vijayanagara. And within a few years, maybe 15-20 years, even 5 years, I think, the Vijayanagara kingdom became very powerful. He built up everything and he became the chief minister of Vijayanagara. Raja, they will put somebody else, but he became the minister. Under his guidance, the Vijayanagara kingdom became very famous and they finally attacked Madurai. Our Islamic rule was going on. Completely liberated Madurai and other places, that area. And you know, Vijayanagara kingdom was in its glory for about next 2 centuries, 200. He built the foundation so well that the kingdom ran in its full glory for about 2 centuries. That was the ruler of ruling of a sannyasin. Being a sannyasin in Shankara Matha, in Sringeri, he left the Matha, went as a minister, guided the kings, established the kings, just like Chanakya, as he put Maurya, that Gupta, what is his name? Chandragupta. Like that, he established the kingdom, fought the invaders out, then made the foundation of the kingdom proper, and after, say, about 30 years, he came back. I may be a little wrong in the data, I don't remember. He came back to the Matha again. And there is a story which says that when he came back, his guru, Bharatititha, asked that, have you forgotten Vedanta? So then, in narrating Vedanta in a brief manner, that is how Panchadashi has come. And people say that some of the chapters have been written by his guru also. As about Padmapada also, it is said that Shankaracharya composed some of the portion. So that is Panchadashi, that he came back and he wrote this for the summary Vedanta. Now there also this Viveka is having a very, very important role everywhere. Why not in any scripture? So we must, this question should arise in our mind, that how in Bhagavad Gita never Viveka has been spoken about? So then we will come to know that actually the whole Bhagavad Gita is dealing only with the Viveka, because it is used the word Yuktata everywhere. Yukta word has been used so many times in Bhagavad Gita. Buddhi Yukta, Buddhi Yukta, Buddhi Yoga, Yogastha. All these means Yogastha, he doesn't mean that you remain in meditation and do everything. Yogastha Kuru Karmani. Can it be that you remain in meditation and do the karma? People explain it like that also. It is absolutely wrong. In the meditative yoga, how can you do any karma? So whatever is the goal of the meditation, the ultimate aim of the meditation, that we are incorporating in the buddhi, in the active life, and then doing the functions, then the activities also become equal or even more important than the yoga, more important a yoga than meditative yoga, because it completely purifies our active life. Personality, everything gets purified by that. So, we discussed that it is the Buddhi Yoga in Bhagavad Gita, which is the Viveka in Sadhana Chatushta of Viveka Chudamani and other places. Now, it starts with the 18th verse in Viveka Chudamani. Sadhanani Atra Chatvari Kathitani Manishivihi येषु सत्स्वेव सन्निष्ठा यदभावे न सिद्ध्यति. He says that these are the fourfold sadhana which the manishis, the saints, the sages have given us. When they remain with us, येषु सत्सु eva sannishtha yadabhave na siddhyati. Our nishtha towards the sat, nishtha towards the truth, nishtha means dedication, will become successful only when we have this fourfold sadhana. Without that, if we mug up the whole of Vedanta also, know all the Upanishads, all the Bhagavad Gita, give very good lectures on that also, the Siddhi will not come. What is the Siddhi? Our ego getting dissolved in the real universal identity, in our real identity. Yoga means the fusion of the small, imposed, created ego into the real identity. That is the ultimate goal. So that goal will not be successful, will not be coming through. If we try to pursue Vedanta without these fourfold qualities. Saying that, he is introducing one after another. आदौ नित्यानित्य वस्तु विवेकः परिगण्यते इहामुत्र फलभोग विरागस्तदनन्तरम् शमादि षड्ग संपत्तिः मुमुक्षुत्वम् इति स्फुटम्। सो ऑल ही हैज सेड, ऑल द फोर ही हैज सेड इन दिस वन श्लोक। व्हाट इज दैट? इट स्टार्ट्स विद द विवेक विच इज कॉल्ड नित्यानित्य वस्तु विवेक। So this viveka is introduced as it is a our buddhi has to distinguish between what is nitya and what is anitya. Nitya means permanent, anitya means futile, impermanent, fleeting. Now normally when we are in the world and we are taking spirituality also as a sadhana, I have been thinking, because we have to speak and everybody says that speak in so that we can apply in our life. So some years back I was thinking that if we explain this nitya nitya viveka, it will not be applicable for people, because who is looking for permanent? Nobody is bothered about permanent and impermanent, what is right and what is wrong. What will keep me on the auspicious path? What will take me away from the auspicious path? We are not able to discriminate. So is it not the same viveka which will tell them this also? So I found that the first phase of viveka should be nitya and anitya is fine. We can relate again as I related Bhagavad Gita. But it should be shreyas and prayas. Shreyaha and priyaha. In Bhagavad Gita, in Kathopanishad, from which Bhagavad Gita has been taken, that shloka says that the world comes always before us with two offering, two baskets. One is shreyas, another is prayas. That means whatever we do, every step we take, it is an option before us and we are supposed to make the choice. We cannot say that, oh my fate, I am fated to do this. No. Our scriptures are always making us responsible for everything happening in our life. Although there is a daiva element that they don't disregard. But in every decision making, we have a free will and we have to take our decision. The God is not going to take decision for us. So, the decision is, am I a seeker of shreyas or am I a seeker of prayas? That is the viveka, that if our mind is looking for the spiritual goal and we have established the soul dimensions in our buddhi, then the decision making becomes very easy. That let us find out, will it take me to the goal or not? What step I am taking? I will take this path or this path? I will do this or don't do this? This decision will be made not by how much of money I am getting out of this, how much of property, position, appreciation, fame, all these things we are going to get, or how much of difficulty I have to face. These are not of consideration. Maybe I will have to take a decision where we have to take a lot of difficulty, not knowing that whether I will be able to course through also. Even then we have to take it, because my viveka is saying that this is the path I have to take. So the decision will be governed by viveka, that am I a seeker of truth? If I am a seeker of truth, I cannot be moved away by the futile, pleasant things of the world, the temporary happiness and temporary gains of the world. I should only look for the permanent. What is the permanent here? The shreyas, the most auspicious, which the soul is. It is universal, it is impartial, it is impersonal, it never looks for any personal gain, selfish gain. It is always to make us selfless than selfish. Our Vishaya Buddhi will always try to make us selfish. And the Yoga Buddhi will always try to make us selfless. So the decisions will be on the basis of that. So Kathopanishad also says that Adhiraha, a wise person, whenever any situation comes, he will go around it. Not only around it, he will cut open every facet of it, look into it, look around it, finally find out that what is the cause of it, what is the result of it, what is the effect of it, will it take me to the auspicious goal or will it take me away from the auspicious goal? And on that basis, dhiraha, the wise people will choose the shreyas, which will take them, shreyas means the auspicious goal, in preference to prayas. Whereas mandaha, those who are always given to gain, they don't have that lofty dimension of the buddhi, lofty dimension of the mind, they don't have. So they will look for the prayers always. Oh, it will give me so much, so I go for this. It will give me more money, I go for this. So Kathopanishad says, yogakshemadvrinite. They want to keep whatever properties they have and they want add more and more possessiveness to that. They are always given, decision is conducted by the possessiveness of their mind. Possessiveness, you understand. So not by the righteousness, not by the auspiciousness, not by the yoga buddhi. So in the first phase of application of viveka, it is the choice between shreyas and prayas. The buddhi should be able to always distinguish between the shreyas and the prayas. Is it meaningful? Even a child should be able to do, say those who have studies in school also, if you explain them properly, they will be able to apply that how you should make your decisions, how are you to choose. Now the problem here is that this discrimination, a very intelligent person will be able to make very well. Say even mathematical scientists or physicists we have found, they're very intelligent. They will be able to distinguish between permanent and temporary very easily, very well. But they will not apply to their life. Suppose we find out that this is only a short-lived pleasure. So, and the other one, if I don't go for it, then I am going for the permanent, the more permanent. Knowing that with their intelligence, they will go for the prayers only, not for the shreyas. So our shastras are very clear that if you find out something is permanent or shreyas and you don't follow, then we don't call it viveka. You get it? You may be very intelligent. You are able to discriminate. In science, in English, you are a very high discrimination you have. But in Sanskrit, no, you don't have viveka. There is no English for viveka. So we have to use the word discrimination. Discrimination you do, but if you don't follow, then it is not so. That is how there are Brahmavadin, speaking about Vedanta, who are leading a very nasty life also, but they lecture in Vedanta also, it is there. We had a very good lecturer in Vedanta in Jamshedpur, who used to create havoc in the family every day. Finally, one day he set fire to his own house. I think that was the end of it, perhaps. The children came running to Swamiji and all. So it happens like that, that people are explaining things, speaking about it, but in their personal life, they have not applied. So then we don't call it viveka. We know a very good person, he is no more there, he was a sannyasin. When he took up sannyasa, after his mother passed away, he was waiting for not the mother to die, but he did not take up sannyasa as long as the mother was there. See, this has a reflection on my life also. When I was going away to ashram, my mother said that after I die, you go. So I kept quiet for some time and then after some time I told my mother that, what you were saying, is it right? Suppose I am very strongly craving for leaving everything and going away to take the spiritual life. Then will I not start thinking that when will my mother die, when will my mother die? Even if I don't say, my mind will see that. Rather, suppose I go now and you gladly send me, then my existence in the ashram will be working so well on your mind, you will find that everything will have a different light for in your life also. Will you not be more happy that I have gone for such a life? And so then mother said, oh, okay, you go. So there is a way of convincing everything also. People say that because of this I could not go, because of that I could not go. It is not so. We can approach through love and wisdom. Everything can be approached. So he, after taking up sannyasa, he went to see his pandita, the master from whom he had learned Vedanta. So when he prostrated before his guru, guru means Shastra Guru, the teacher prostrated before him immediately. He said, no, prostration is due to you. I have taught you Vedanta, but the phala, the result of Vedanta has not flowered in me. Otherwise, I would not have been there here. I would have taken up sannyasa long back. The result of studying Vedanta is completely getting rid of the worldliness from your mind. I have taught you Vedanta, but the worldliness has not left me. But you have been able to cut off worldliness and go to there. So I must prostrate before you, not you before me. So these things happen. People are there. So in our shastras, if you have the discrimination, but if you don't follow the shreyas, path of shreyas, then we don't call it viveka. So now you can find that why viveka will automatically lead to vairagya. Because viveka means it is you are deliberating between what is permanent and what is temporary, what is shreyas, what will lead you to shreyas and what will lead you to prayas. And you will follow shreyas, you will follow the permanent. That is the soul dimensions. Now what is the soul dimensions, you tell me? The soul never gets affected by anything, sukha, dukkha, nothing taints it. It never has any selfishness, jealousy or blamingness, nothing. It only reveals everything. Is it not vairagya? Vairagya means that raga means the special color we apply to the world. Raga can two things. One is color, another is clinging to what I like, what is mine, clinging to that. Both are raga. So vairagya, the word has come from viraga, that means removing that color. When I remove that color, that personal preference and color of personal prejudice and preference, then only it is vairagya. So by incorporating the soul dimensions, am I not incorporating vairagya in me, colorlessness in me? Vairagya is not walking out from the home and getting into a cave and doing tapasya there. That is only a preliminary vairagya which may not have final lay also. As Bhagavad Gita says that nirāhārasya dehinaḥ rasa bhajjam, that you leave the viṣaya and walk off. Then viṣaya means the world. World will remain away from you, fine. But rasa bhajjam, except the taste for viṣaya, that will not go. You may go to the cave or the forest. When you come back again, they will pounce upon you with redoubled force. Rasa bhajjam, then what to do with the rasa? Rasa bhajjam, rasopi asya, rasaha api asya, param drishtva nivartate. When you see the param, the ultimate truth, when you get fused into that, then the taste for viṣaya also will not be there. Why? Because you understand that it has been a delusion, no joy is there in anything in the world. All the source of joy is right within me, in myself, my identity right there in the inmost level. All the joy I am looking for is right within me. So why should I look for joy from here, there, thinking that it will mean? It becomes a foolish, absolutely foolish. So the desires become redundant. Will you foster anymore any desire? Desires are coming because we are under the delusion that this will make me happy. When you understand that this will not going to make you happy, and not only that, the happiness is not outside, it is within. And it is always oozing forth. Because our mind, because of this delusion, is always running after external things, we are missing that happiness. So the desires are working in the reverse gear. Not in that they are not making us happy. It is taking us away from the happiness. Do you get my point? So if you understand this truth, then will it not become all foolish? So rasa bhajjam, but in this case, rasa api asya param drishtva nivartate. When he understands that there is nothing in the world at all to become happy, then that taste for the viṣayas also will go. But he will function in the world without that. As the soul is displaying the whole universe, he will also remain active in the universe in its own manner. Nobody will know from outside. In his inside, it will be like the everything falling on the lotus leaf. The water will fall and water will go. It is like that, it will go on. So my purpose was to explain that how Viveka leads to Vairagya. Is it understood? This Viveka and Vairagya, they are the, in Viveka Chudamani, they are like the two wings of a bird. You can fly anywhere you like with these two wings. Nobody is going to hinder you. Anywhere, in the king's palace or in the beggar's shanty. Wherever you go, no suffering, no special elation, nothing. These are the two wings on which a human being is supposed to fly on. There is a shloka in Vivek Chudamani about it. Now, as Vairagya increases, Vairagya means these dimensions of the soul, that unaffectedness, impersonality, impartiality, as it increases, will not your buddhi also will develop more and more viveka, further clarity, further sharpness of the buddhi will dawn automatically. That is why we say that the clarity is the last word in spirituality. You will hear Swamiji often mentions. Clarity means when the viveka and vairagya go to their ultimate level, then things are absolutely clear before you. Decision making is not at all a problem. Even if a wrong decision comes also, you are never going to be affected by that. Theek hai, chalega. Kuch hoga, acha bhi hoga. So you become absolutely swabhavika, natural. Now these two, viveka and vairagya, together will give rise to the Shamadamadi Shatka Sampattihi. What is that? They have given the sequence Shamadama Titiksha Uparati Shraddha Samadhana. When the mind, their expression is like this, the finds fault with the world and it is remaining quiet, quiescent in the ultimate goal of life, then that is called the Shama. It is middle Shama. Now, this finding fault with the world, this is a traditional Vedantic language. So our modern people do not like it, that dosha drishti. Why should you find fault in the world always? It was discussed in the manner that we are too much glued to the world. So, by constant ninda, constant finding fault, that it is only to take away the glue. When the glue is removed, then you don't have to find fault with the world. There won't be any problem with the world at all. As Ragadvesha Vijuktaistu Vishayanindriyascharan Atmavashair Vidheyatma Prasadam Adigachati. When the ragadvesha from the mind has gone, the ragadvesha duality, they have gone, then you don't have to find fault anywhere at all. You will automatically not cling to anything, you will not hate also anything. So this dosha drishti, as they have defined, it is necessary in the initial stage because we are too much glued to the world. The other day, 2-3 days back, we received a letter from our Bhuvana, who came here a few days back. We had seen her after maybe 2 decades or so. Her mother was staying here. So she has written that when they were going back, 10 minutes before the flight was supposed to land, there was a huge sound. And everybody was quite terrified, and the announcement came that it is passing through a terribly rough weather. We are going to land, but because of the weather, we may have to divert the flight also. So everybody started calling God, because only then we remember God. Na? Before that, nobody will remember God. So she has described beautifully that how the person on the other side was doing japa, or how she herself was doing. She has analyzed her mind also very well, because she was so much involved in what they are doing and what is happening and all. Suddenly she discovered that I may not be there after a few minutes or seconds. I may not be there. Now that is, for that no plane accident has to happen. Here one circuit may break and we may fall dead. Anytime. Next second. Just something, a small thing. Weather doesn't have to become turbulent and the plane doesn't have to wobble there. Something, a small circuit breaking here, we will fall dead. But we don't remember it. That causes the problem. The glue is because of that. If we remember, that is why in sadhana it is there, the mrityu chinta, it is a great sadhana. It's not a nihilistic sadhana that, oh, why should you think about death? It is only to remind us that what we are holding on, nothing is permanent here. Whatever we are holding on, nothing is permanent. Anytime the person we are holding on to becomes the greatest in the whole world for us. Actually, I am the greatest, and whatever I am holding on to, they are also having the reflected greatness. Is it not so? That we love even our partner also, we love because of our own pleasure. These are all discussed in great detail in Brihadaranyaka. Yajnavalkya is telling Maitri that, oh Maitri, people love their wife, love their husband, not for the wife, not for the husband, but for their own self. So like that, if we remember that the life also is temporary, then we will not be swayed by it. Whenever a person has made some wrong remarks or abusive remarks, oh, the whole world has fallen. We give so much of importance, and Swamiji quotes one lady that she said that till my body is taken to the pyre, I will not be able to forgive her. So much of aggrandization of the... So actually this dosha drishtya means it is by that clear vision that everything is futile. Don't exaggerate anything. Don't magnify anything. Be simple about everything. So the shama will dawn by that also. Because what is agitating our mind? You look into your mind, what is agitating? All these small things constantly agitating our mind. They are all offshoots of desire, either positive desire or negative desire, clinging to what we like and hating what we dislike. They are constantly agitating our mind for nothing. We are collecting them and we are getting stressed by it. You look into your mind, one day, even if you don't sit for meditation, one day you sit to look into your mind, that how much of stress points are there. Each such thoughts is creating stress in different portions of the brain. You can discover the stress, it is all created by us, it is not by the world. The moment we focus on that point and remove the corresponding ragadvesha hiding there, you will find that gets relaxed. Hold on to another, maybe the first one is my own husband itself or wife. The second one, my friend or neighbor. Hold on to that. Act on it by applying the removal of ragadvesha. You will find great relaxation. Like that, if you remove all those things, you will find the mind as if you have taken a bath inside. That is the shama. Shama means the mind as if it has taken a bath within. It is no more carrying on with the stresses created by raga dvesha, by desires, by hatred, all by blaming tendencies, all these are completely gone. So that is the quality called shama. Now without shama, neither will you be able to successful in meditation, nor in knowledge pursuit, nor in Bhagavad Gita Buddhi Yoga. This shama is a must. But they are not saying that shama you have to cultivate. You have to cultivate only viveka, which will give rise to vairagya, which will give rise to shama. So सो यू डोंट हैव टू बी फियरफुल अबाउट कि कैसे इतना सब कुछ करेंगे, करना है एक ही. विवेका मीन्स अप्लाई योर डिस्क्रिमिनेशन एंड फॉलो इट, विदाउट फॉलोइंग यू कैनॉट डू. सी आवर पीपल वर वेरी सिंसियर, their arguments were not like today's argument that you sit in the dining hall over a cup of tea, you argue, and then when it is gone, it is gone, nothing to do with your life. Their arguments were all extremely sincere. When Shankaracharya and Mandana Mishra were arguing, what was the condition? That if Shankaracharya gets defeated, he will leave sannyasa and take to the household life. If Mandana Mishra gets defeated, he will have to take up sannyasa. And who was the judge? Mandana Mishra's wife. So the wife has to give the judgment that my husband has lost. So at the cost of what? Her sumangalya. She will become widow. So they had that faith in keeping the wife as the judge, where if the argument Mandana Mishra loses, then he will take up sannyasa. Can you think of somebody keeping the wife as the judge there? So much was their faith in people. So much was their sincerity. And they knew that if I get defeated, I have to do this. And for that, nothing was less important. To win over the argument, whatever they had to do, they will do. But if they lose, then they have to accept the defeat and take to the other person's. So, Viveka means whatever you find to be the final thing, to be the Shreyas, to be the goal, you have to follow it. You cannot say that tomorrow I will follow, or from next year I will do, or after I retire I will follow. Then it is not Viveka. After retirement, you will again look for another, another, another. When all are gone, if you have to look after grandchildren, then we'll forget about no further in further employment is not necessary. I have now to look after two grandchildren. So such retirement is never going to come. So we have only to apply the Viveka. And as I said, what is Viveka? You follow Bhagavad Gita, put your buddhi, anchor your buddhi in the yoga, that is in the real identity, the soul dimension, which is universal, uniform, untainted, impartial, impersonal. This is enough. All other things will come along with it. And on that basis, take the decisions of life. Even if you have to take some decision which apparently appears to be something selfish or so. It may look like, but your mind should be clear that I am not doing it on a selfish ground. Just like Arjuna. He was initially thinking that Duryodhana, he has been thinking, meditating on Duryodhana, and I will defeat him and win back my kingdom. For what? Greed for Rajya Sukha Lobha. Rajya Sukha. But when it changed, he is fighting the same war. For the same purpose, maybe they won the kingdom, sat on the kingdom. But in his mind, what it is? He is fighting the war because Krishna wanted it. And why should Krishna want? Because Krishna is somebody who has identified with the universal Atma, the I. And his decisions are the natural decisions for Arjuna also. And whatever he says, he will do. And he was doing also. Wherever crisis was there, whatever Yudhishthira did not do, Arjuna did. Whatever was said, he did. So, truly speaking, it is not that difficult. It is a loyalty to the Guru, surrender to the Guru, whatever you may say. Finally, having a full faith that where lies my, I only want to reach my auspicious goal. And where lies my auspicious goal, I don't know myself. But my Guru knows better than me where lies my auspicious goal. So as long as I don't know, as long as the Guru is available, I will follow the Guru. Whatever he says, I will do. What else is this? and for that everything else is secondary. This is Viveka, and that will give rise to Vairagya, that you will become so impersonal that nothing will touch you, although you will have universal love for everybody. You will be loving everybody but not getting entangled to anything at all. You will be able to take decisions easily without getting affected. Even if you get affected, sometimes some harsh decision to be taken, you will be having the enough strength to bear with that decision also. Say the kings, when they give some capital punishment or something, can you imagine the torture a good king's mind will have? Good kings, not bad kings. Good kings, when they have to punish somebody, they would be suffering like anything. But his yoga buddhi will give him the power to withstand that. He will make him a magnificent sufferer, as Yoga Vasishtha says. He will be able to withstand that also. Here in this Sadhana Chatushtaya, there is another strangeness that Shama comes first and Dama follows. In Yoga Shastra, Dama comes first and Shama follows. Because Yoga Shastra, everything starts from the physical level. And then you go to the higher and higher, subtler and subtler level. But here, it starts from the soul level, right there in the buddhi level. And there, if Shama is established, the mind becomes desireless. Without a desireless mind, Shama will not dawn. Or mind understands the delusion, the myth of the world, that I am never going to be happy by gaining anything from the world at all. When that maya gets removed from the intelligence will be able to guide us. And when the shama dawns in our mind, automatically our indriyas will be guided by the inner realm. It will no more be guided by the external slavery, because the mind has overcome the slavery. So that mind will make the indriyas automatically they will be under our discipline, control. That is why the Dhamma is coming after that. That it is not an external control that we are talking about as in Yoga Shastra. It's an internal guidance, natural guidance from the inmost soul through the buddhi, through the mind to the external body. So you will not have to struggle with your greed and other things. It will be controlled by within. Prabuddham vimuktam vikaradihinam prasannam sada nitya bodha swarupam param nischalam nirgunam sarvarupam bhajeham sadanu smarami pranomi prabuddham vimuktam vikaradihinam prasannam sada nitya bodha swarupam param nischalam nirgunam sarvarupam bhajeham sadanu smarami pranami.